Dear Most Honourable Sir Simon of the Clergy, your fellow clergymen, clergy women, clergy dogs and cats, in fact, any clergy person who may aid in my possible acquittal.
That's everyone covered.
Okay. I think so. It's a little bit desperate, Marie, but anyway, never mind. My confession dates to the year of 1987, when I was 19 and naughty and blissfully disconnected from the concept of consequences. Before I continue, I must state, in my one and only defence, that this incident was not planned, as I've just mentioned, not premeditated, it was not considered. It really did happen in a moment of nonchalant reaction, which retrospectively may have changed the course of history. And for this, I wholeheartedly and absolutely and abjectly apologise.
Big build up to this.
I know. I don't want to disappoint you. Anyway, Marie says, I've always been known to play the clown, and I'm often responsible for either reducing friends and family to fits of giggles, or indeed giggling myself at inappropriate times when not giggling would have been a more suitable option. I guess the word mischievous fits me very well. Don't think that's played very well, by the way, Marie.
Okay.
Story begins with myself and my friend heading on foot into town early one evening to partake in probable beverage-enhanced frivolity. As you'll recall, there were no mobile phones in 1987. Instead, those good old, rather unpleasant-smelling red telephone boxes were generally positioned, quite readily, on many a street corner. Sometimes, as you may have experienced firsthand, they would ring, and on this occasion, the one that we were passing was indeed ringing. The loud, echoing... You remember that sound?
Remember what a phone sounds like?
Made me stop in my tracks. Now, what I should have done was the normal, sensible action of pulling open the heavy, squeaking door and simply picking up the telephone to inform the unsuspecting person, it's enough of that, on the other end, that they had misdialed to a public phone box and not a private number, as they undoubtedly thought that they had rung. That's what they intended. However, that's what I should have done. What happened was the exact opposite. Hello, I spoke into the mouthpiece of the black, heavy, cold instrument. Makes it sound like a weapon.
Mm-hmm. Phone.
This was followed by a short pause and then, who are you? Said a rather irritated and, if I may say, slightly possessive-sounding female voice. I don't know how you do possessive. Who are you? How's that?
That's okay. It's pretty good.
Well, who are you? I responded, maybe in a slightly menacing tone, but impromptu nonetheless. Well, where's Mike? Came back at me down the phone.
Oh, dear.
Again, if I may say so, with a rather unnecessary angry nature. Thinking on my feet, I then uttered the three words I've regretted ever since.
Oh, dear.
He's in bed.
Oh, no.
Another short silence. He's what? He's in bed, I repeated. The voice down the phone, well, you'd better not be in bed with him.
Okay.
Well, I'm not anymore, I said. I am on my way over! Came bellowing down the earpiece, followed by the clicking noise and a dead tone that indicated I'd just been disconnected. I think she hung up on me, I said. I remember thinking that as we continued our jaunt into town, that every car passing us could contain Mike's seething, raging girlfriend or fiancé or whoever on her way to confront him. And over the years, over the many, many years since then, I still wonder what became of Mike and his rather uppity girlfriend. And clearly, what I might have said might have led to a few uncomfortable moments.
You think?
So I kind of need mercy and forgiveness, but not from Mike's girlfriend, but from Mike himself, who was probably just eating his dinner on a tray, on his lap, watching the A-Team, or something, the way we did back then, and oblivious to why his now very enraged better half was about to burst in to his home like a woman possessed and ransack his bedroom, screeching, where is she? My only consolation to this day is that had Mike actually been a naughty boy, I might have done somebody somewhere a favour, but maybe I'm being slightly desperate there. I think, Marie, you almost certainly are, but it's thinking on her feet. She says, where's Mike? She says he's in bed. Not with me. Not anymore. Thank you very much indeed. Let's see what Sister Bobby makes of that.
It's difficult because I understand if you're a mischievous type and, you know, lots of things are funny. However, you were 19 and...
Adult.
Yeah, you are an adult and you kind of are aware because when she said, when you said, oh, he's in bed because you thought that might be mischievous and she said... I hope not still with you. That would have been your time, actually, to go, OK, the mischievousness has now gone too far. I need to come straight with this. I need to be... You could have saved that at any point. I understand maybe first two steps, the first two dalliances down the funny road, but you should have got out of this. So, Marie, I'm going to tell you, you are not acquitted.
Not acquitted.
Not forgiven.
Harsh, but maybe fair,
well,
Brother Matthew.
I think very fair, because, I mean, yes, I agree. There were a number of points in this conversation where you could have steered it away and go, ha, actually, you've just dialed a random phone box and I just picked up the phone and isn't this very, very amusing? However, you went along with it, and you went along with it until she puts down the phone. So she obviously is thinking there's some strange woman in her boyfriend's flat. So I am not going to forgive. And I admit, if that means that I no longer have the morals of a sewer rat, then so be it, because someone has to take a stand.
Is it not the woman on the other end of the phone, the uppity girlfriend? Is it not her fault?
Well, here's the other thing. How does she get called uppity? Just because she dials a number thinking it's the right number, and some strange woman answers at her boyfriend's place. I think she's well within her rights to be...
Uppity and possessive, says
no,
Marie.
No, I don't think she's being uppity at all. I think she's being well within her rights to have a go.
How can she be possessive, Marie, if she is the girlfriend and you've alluded to another woman?
Yeah.
So that's not possessiveness.
Oh, so yeah, very much backing me up there, Bobby. Well done.